Hello and welcome to the 12th episode of Design Education Talks, the collaboration between the team here of the New Art School and the Design Dedux podcast. Our guest today is Derek Jones. Welcome, Derek.
How are you doing, Left Dennis? Thanks.
Fantastic. Good. It's great that you're here. So tell us about you.
Wow. Okay. My name is Derek Jones. I'm a senior lecturer in sustainable design at the Open University in the UK. The Open University is a distance learning institution. Prior to that, I was also a professional architect, 15 years in professional practice as an architect, a developer, and also a bit of a sort of computer visualizer and sort of web designer as well, way back when it wasn't very good, and you don't want to talk about that. So yeah, I'm a bit of a practitioner and a bit of an educator.
Brilliant combination. So what is it that that you're working on? What is it that you're doing today?
The past few weeks obviously has been spent in sort of COVID-19 response, if you like. And particularly trying to support colleagues who are moving from proximate design education to distance design education. At the Open University, as I say, we teach at a distance. We have done for 50 years, nearly 50 years. And it's a very different way of doing things. So we're trying to help colleagues for whom this is completely new. The analogy that I keep giving to my colleagues here is it's like, you know, we never sometimes see our students physically. So it's as if 40,000 students have just turned up at our front door and were demanding to be taught. That's almost the kind of scale, if you like, of pivot that some people are having to do, because design education is so fundamentally, most of it is so fundamentally premised on the proximity model, you know, that you have to be there absolutely with the practitioner, absolutely, you know, the kind absolutely of the expert or the apprenticeship model. And, you know, we don't do that. We do not have an apprenticeship model like that. We've got a slightly different apprenticeship model. It's a slightly different model. But we do that from the start. And, you know, we've got 50 years, as I say, experience of doing that. So it's been quite hard to get that across to colleagues, how we actually help colleagues make that transition. It's been interesting times. Not been a lot of sleep over the last few weeks.
But you're at a quite unique place because you have the practitioner role. Mm-hmm. And the researcher.
Yes, absolutely.
So tell us about this transition before we get into more of the... Mm-hmm.
The transition itself is actually an interesting one, and it's maybe one that'll sort of touch on what people might be interested in this, because it's, you know, I present regularly on how we teach at a distance, you know, to colleagues around the world, and it's usually that first moment, you can see it in their eyes, you can see that moment where they go, what do you mean you teach design at a distance? How can you teach design at a distance? You know, what crazy plane have you got off? That's how I started at the Open University. So I was a practicing architect. I'd actually started studying with the Open University. I started studying mathematics, believe it or not. I've nearly got a degree in mathematics with the Open University. And I was just totally blown away by the fact that they completely flipped all my understanding, not just of mathematics, but of education, of how you do education. And lesson one was, look, you're going to be learning. Nobody had told me how to actually do learning before. And as soon as, you know, that kind of, it's almost like the scales fall away from your eyes. As soon as you have that epiphany, you kind of get into it. You realize that you're doing something different for yourself, and it's a different kind of model, if you like, of education. So anyway, I became a big fan of the Open University, and I decided to apply to do a bit of part-time tutoring because I really wanted to know, how do you do this kind of thing? How do you go about it? And I saw this advert for design lecturers. Well, it's what we call tutors, part-time lecturers. Yeah. Or something, lecturers. And I thought, that's crazy. How do you teach design at a distance? This is going to be hilarious. So I applied almost as I kind of out of like sick curiosity, thinking it's going to be one of those rubbish online courses you get, you know. This is how you design a house, and you get somebody drawing a rectangle and saying, that's a house. That's not to dismiss, because there are some fantastic how to be an architect and there's some fantastic stuff online, but there's also a lot of junk. So anyway, I did that, applied to that, and I got the position, because one of the interview questions was, how would you repackage a banana? You know, it was, you know, you've got to respond in that instant. And again, I think what we got from that first cohort was a lot of people who got that job simply because were able to respond to that type of question.
So what was the response?
Well, my response was you could use like an old toothpaste tube, and you peel the banana, you put the banana into the toothpaste tube, and you can squirt it into your mouth. So, but it's one of those problems. It's kind of like, to me, it goes back to the Ray and Charles Eames report, Designing Design Education for India. They, instead of producing a big report on what the curriculum should be, they gave the Indian government three examples of design project. Now, just think about that. You know, you've done this work. I don't know, what was it, a year and a half of study? They went around all the different sort of educational places and also the practice places in India, and they came up with this tiny, thin, slim document. And to me, it's still one of the greatest pieces of sort of communication and design education.
What was the year? What was the year of that?
Oh, goodness me. Let me see. I've got Zotero running as well. I'll be able to give you just right now. Let's see. I think it was 67 or something like that. So it was before that, 58. Yeah. My God, fantastic. 1958. I'll send you a link.
Oh, great,
you can share
great.
A link to it.
Yeah.
Anyway, that was their premise was, I'm not going to tell you what to do. This isn't a guide on what to do, but we'll give you examples of project. So one of the projects, for example, was design a postal service. And just in that simple sentence, you have a level of complexity that goes beyond just, you know, make a stick that hits something or a really simple functional design object. You know, it has to be a system, it has to be a service, it has to interface with human behaviors and all that kind of stuff. So that's kind of like what's nice about the how would you repackage a banana. It's a non-trivial problem. It's an open-ended problem. There is no solution. B, there's only ways to respond. And I think that to me is still the fundamental difference between a designer and, say, an engineer or, you know, other practitioners. We don't have a right answer. We only have responses to problems. Mm-hmm. We never, ever, ever solve problems. So there we go. That was the interview question. And that's what got me into teaching design education. And when I started teaching design education, first of all, I didn't teach design education. That wasn't my role. And it's not what we do at the Open University. We don't teach. We force people to learn. That sounds a bit dogmatic, doesn't it? But it's kind of like we deliberately flip the model. You know, we flip that. We've done the flipped classroom since 1971. You know, you have to. You're not there. So the onus has to be on the learning. Suddenly, when you're in that mode of tuition, supporting students to do that learning, you have to actually understand how it is that people do design, and you have to then understand how people can learn to be designers. You have to make all of that explicit. And I think there's a lot of implicit stuff that happens in the traditional education, studio education, that you don't have to almost interrogate your work. As long as designers come out the other end, nobody really kind of questions it. So for me, that was the big epiphany moment. That was a big transformation for me personally. Nobody had ever taught me, in 7 years of architecture education, nobody had ever taught me how to actually design. Nobody had actually sat down and said, you are being a designer. Not that this is the process you go through, but this is, if you like, the cognitive process you go through. That was a big epiphany for me. Completely converted me to different modes, if you like, of design education. And the fact that sometimes we can be a bit lazy as design educators and not interrogate what it is that we do because we just fall into the same behaviours of practice. Again, not all design educators mm-hmm. are like that, and there's masses of other issues round about design education, you know, the time that's given to staff to be able to do this in the first place, the fact that a lot are practitioners and trying to be educators at the same time, you know, almost everything's stacked against you. So I'm really, really fucking lucky I've had that opportunity to be able to reflect on both my design practice, my education practice, and that those two things have kind of come together. Sorry, that was a really long-winded answer. I'll try not to talk so much.
No, please. This is
sorry.
Flowing of thought, really, and consciousness.
Hopefully.
Yeah, I mean, the thing is, in design education, we are creating an experience.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
So it's almost as if it's everything but the information. So that's the challenge, I guess, you know, because
yeah,
design education has changed a lot. And there is various conflicting views these days, which we'll go into a bit later on. But when we are teaching design, we are creating an experience. Mm-hmm. And it's almost things that are not said, because you cannot, for example, have a lesson plan. Mm-hmm. You know, we're all taught. Yep. I did my postgraduate master's in education. This is lesson plan and this and that. Of course, you cannot have a lesson plan because there's a dynamism in the way the students respond. So you might have something else. You're actually responding on the fly.
Yeah.
So you created experience. Mm-hmm. How can this happen in a long distance environment?
So first of all, I hear what you're saying about the lesson plan, but I would have to disagree with that, and I would have to disagree with it quite strongly, because it's okay to say that, well, I'll draw you a quick lesson plan here. So basically, here's the lesson plan. We're going to start with the prompt here.
Yeah.
Something's going to happen in the middle, and stuff will happen at the end. Now, I think we can actually be a bit more confident and competent about those type of lesson plans. So let me give you an example. At the Open University, we will actually have quite prescriptive lesson plans at the start, but they will be deliberately prescriptive in the sense that they deliberately require multiple responses to come out. So that's where the experience thing comes in, left terrace. So you start with almost we use a lot of design methods, for example. So we will give students quite a prescriptive design method, because they've never experienced maybe a creative design process whatsoever. That's the other big thing about us as an institution. And one of the big different things, a lot of our students don't come from design backgrounds. They don't self-select. These are students that maybe are halfway through a career, halfway through a life, and doing something completely different. So we can't assume they have any sort of creative prior knowledge whatsoever. So for them, this
so you're
is
starting. The, you're starting from zero. Yeah,
absolutely. In fact, sometimes we're actually starting from negative.
Wow.
We're actually starting. Well, think about it. We are having students who have come through an education system, maybe 18 years in an education system, where they are told there is one right answer, a single right answer, and we have to say to them that's not necessarily true. We have to actually get them to relearn and redo things. We can maybe talk about that a bit later.
Yeah.
So we have to give them a really guided process. So we use design methods a lot. But just because you've got a lesson plan, it doesn't mean that there can't be, in fact, it's not just a conditional thing. In design, there has to be an element of that plan that says, I don't know what's going to happen here, or this bit we can't plan for explicitly. But, and this is the critical difference. Sorry, mate, I'm going to get really quite assertive about this bit.
Yeah.
It bugs me that as designers, we don't confront this a bit more positively and actually say, just because I don't know what I'm doing now, that doesn't mean that what I'm doing is worthless. It doesn't mean that I'm ignorant. I am still going somewhere with this. And that's a different kind of planning. That's the difference between, I don't know, say, maybe there's a semantic thing here, so please forgive me. I don't know the literature. I don't know. I'm not too knowledgeable on this. It's maybe the difference between a learning objective, you know, something that's quite explicit, such as you will learn, you know,
an outcome,
Newton's first law, for example. Compared to a learning aim, which is you will get some experience of dealing with uncertainty.
Yeah.
Now, that to me is a designer's learning objective or learning aim.
Of course.
So a classic example would be where we have tried to use design methods to teach science, and it doesn't work where you have an explicit learning outcome.
Of course.
But if you take away that explicit learning outcome and say, yes, but they will gain experience of the method of using science in a process, that's a completely different thing. Now, we need to get far better, left terrace, as design educators, speaking to normal education colleagues and to administrators to say, with all of that stuff, no, I can be confident about this uncertainty, because uncertainty is useful, okay? A classic example is COVID-19. What we're doing just now necessarily has to deal with uncertainty.
Yeah.
We have to. You can't not do that. Otherwise, you will end up with idiotic solutions. That's all I'm going to say on that matter.
Yeah, no, absolutely. I mean, so we're really feeling the elephant from different angles, really. We're talking about the same thing.
But yes, absolutely.
You are actually contextualizing it and talking about it as learning aims.
Yeah, but I think I was going to sum up and just do a summary lesson for educators on that. It's having that ability to be able to talk about that in ways that other people can understand, because this is the other thing. If you speak to, say, an administrator in a university, and again, I don't mean to tar all administrators with the same brush, or maybe somebody that comes from a more deterministic education background or a traditional education background, what we do can seem totally alien, and it's not appropriate in, say, other spaces. So again, I think us having better language, or us being more confident about how we talk about our own pedagogies, our own ways of educating and practicing as well, I think is really quite important. And I think we should teach our students about that too, that as design practitioners, you know, again, another bugbear, you know, you show your client the last fancy picture that you did, the last great, and I did that as well when I had my visualization business, when I had my own small practice. You don't show the 99,000, you know, that big pile of sketches, the stuff that doesn't work, all the crap, you never show that. But that's where the fucking work is. That's where the effort is. So when you go to a client, the client says, is this it? You know, it's almost as if we sell ourselves short by not having better words, better language, better ways of communicating the effort, the uncertainty, the complexity, the difficulty, the, you know, the hard effort that we put into design. We should not be ashamed of talking about that far more assertively. Sorry.
No, absolutely.
I'm getting preachy here.
No, absolutely. Absolutely. It's hard for the client. It's hard because then if you make them privy to the process, then they might even start attacking the process, and then they have to attacking the end result.
Again, I have no problem with this. Well, personally speaking, but again, that's because I've been through the Open Universities method. Okay, I'll rephrase that, because there are some design schools that do actually teach method as well.
Yes.
I think we should be more open with clients about the processes and the methods that we go through. Because one of the things that I can do sometimes with my sketches, and I've done this with clients before, particularly in architecture, is to show them not failure as something that's a waste, but failure that's actually something that's constructive. So when a client says, well, why don't we do it this way? You can whip out the sketch and say, absolutely, this is why. And in fact, we've actually, you know, latterly, particularly when I was working in building information modeling and digital prototyping, actually keeping in your digital prototypes, prototypes that don't work, or prototypes that are good warnings as to not what to do, because, you know, if you do this first, it will block out this opportunity or whatever it might be. Even just having that awareness of process is actually quite important. And I think we should teach that more in design. I don't think, and I hate to see it, I hate to see designers saying, you can't question me, I'm the designer.
No.
My process is mysterious.
Of course not. There's nothing mysterious about design thinking. And for my clients, I'm extremely open about it. In fact, I take them to the process.
Yeah, exactly. You know, that to me is, that's almost the next stage, I think, of design cognition or design thinking. Again, I have a colleague, Theodore Zamanopoulos at the Open University. That's his big thing. He would love to see the transformation that when you design, you empower everybody around about you.
No, absolutely.
Empowering.
I take it because they need to know the process, because we are co-creating.
Yeah,
absolutely. We are co-creating.
I suppose the downside to that would be Lucy Kimball's criticism of not just design thinking, but also co-creation. It's the, just because, you know, there's nothing magical about the process, it doesn't mean that there's nothing special about what you do, because you as a designer with, you know, I've got, 25 years experience, God, that's quite a lot, of doing this as a process, that experience isn't nothing. You know, so that is valuable, but it doesn't mean that it's special in terms of unique.
But if
that makes sense.
Yeah. If we're talking about client and designer, then there's a body of knowledge that the designer can handle better, but there's also some elements that the client knows better because it's about them.
Yeah, sure.
It's a combination of these two areas of knowledge that we're combining in the co-creation. But that's the professional side.
Yeah.
How can your ideas and your experience, of course, in the Open University help all those frustrated colleagues right now that are really trying, including myself, of course, hard to make the best out of teaching online?
Yeah, so that's a difficult one. And to be quite honest with you, Lev Terrace, I don't know. We've got a partial, I'm not going to even say solution to this, response to this, but it's not perfect, simply because you know, we've done this from the start. So we start from a very different position. Our students know they're going to be taught at a distance from the start. So it's not, you cannot take what we do and just transplant it straight away. I think I've mentioned this to you before. You know, it can take us 1 to sometimes even 3 years to develop a single course, single module at the Open University. And it can cost millions of pounds. And I'm not exaggerating that, millions of pounds. You know, we do TV production with the BBC in the UK. We do software development. We do interactive development. We do lots and lots and lots of stuff. A writing team on a module can, you know, go up to about 12 different authors and include many different peer reviews. It's a complex process. So there's no way that colleagues can pivot to that, you know, within a week, 2 weeks or 3 weeks. So I think we do need to break it down into stages. We've had an emergency response, what we can do within, you know, days, weeks. So we've been trying to help colleagues by producing sort of recipes, quick guides on how to do small things, little things, things that can help quickly. But again, we are almost not experts in doing that. We are experts in doing it in a particular way. So I think maybe that expertise might be useful when we come to the medium term and perhaps even the long-term thinking. Because I think what we can do with our model, we could actually dial back a bit on the very high production values, and we could, you know, use that high production stuff for what it's good at doing. And then the more emergent and constructivist stuff, you know, the kind of the stuff as we were talking about earlier that you can't plan for, the studio stuff, the emergent stuff, that's the kind of stuff that might be more useful, I think, for colleagues in the medium term, because that's also stuff that we can, what shall we say, we can plan for and allow for, but we can't fully predict.
Yes.
And we are, you know, to this day, we are still surprised by the stuff that our students come up with and the ways that they can break our systems. I love it. It's absolutely great when somebody turns around and said, was I supposed to do this? How did you do that, man? How did you? So yeah, I think we can do a lot more of that, and it'd be good if we could actually start to, I mean, this is what's going to be good for us. You know, it's not just us delivering our expertise to others, but it's how, it's almost how we are changed by working with other people in different contexts and different situations, and how we can learn from that and how we might be able to do things together with other colleagues. So that's an open invitation to anybody that wants to play with any of this stuff with us. It'd be great to try some new stuff.
Absolutely, absolutely. In your experience through the this long distance teaching, how does it enable students to go into a career, into professionalism? So how what is that relationship between the long distance teaching and professionalism and finding employment?
So it's interesting you should ask that, simply because we've actually just been doing some big research. I'm not going to be able to answer this fully, but it would be good to do a follow-up answer in some way, somehow, because it's actually a couple of colleagues who are looking at that just now. The first thing is that, well, again, it touches on the issue of the fact that our students are different. We represent almost a complete spectrum of population of students. They don't necessarily want to be practicing designers as a result of studying our course. They want to maybe use creative methods, or we have a lot of business students, for example, doing the old overlap between business and creativity, or art students who are maybe wanting to sort of inflect their sort of study of art into practice. Similarly, we also get a lot of teachers, believe it or not, either teaching art and design education, or what we call techie education in the UK. Until quite recently. I'm showing my age there. That's outrageous. I'm a big believer in design as a mode of education for teachers, because I think teaching is also quite a practice-based thing. That's another issue. So we get students from all walks of life almost using this. Again, as it was originally formulated at the OU as design cognition, as design methods, you know, it's the forerunner to design thinking. And it's a slightly different formulation of design thinking, in that it goes back to that black box model we talked about. It's the less prescriptive process. So by the time our students graduate, we hope that they can almost approach any problem. And I don't mean that they've got the knowledge to solve any problem or to have the expertise to deal with any problem, but that they won't freeze, you know, they won't panic when they come across a complex problem, that they will be able to sit down and say, right, what is it that I need to do about this? Or how might I start to explore it? Or how might I play with it? Or how might I, you know, they've got this massive toolbox, this massive toolkit that they graduate with, a toolkit of competencies, of beliefs, of attitudes, of skills. It's not just, and it's certainly not the skills, and it's certainly not thinking Photoshop skills, okay? Sorry, I don't know.
Of course not. No, of course not. What I'm talking about, sort of, you know, the transition. So of course, mm-hmm. some are studying design for other reasons, yeah? Or
no, absolutely, yeah.
Can help students go into many careers because design is a way of thinking and doing.
Yep, absolutely.
One of our successful students in England made an amazing pub, really, really successful pub. So he designed
the. We have quite a few of those as well. We have quite a few examples of students who have just gone on to do these kind of like really weird and slightly different things, and also a lot of online content producers. You know, there isn't a course for how to be an online content producer. So having, no. And I think quite a few design schools are doing this now, having a kind of almost like a general sort of studio approach to say, well, whatever it is you want to do, we've got the mode, if you like, to help you investigate that. That to me is what's so exciting about the way that we're thinking about design as a mode of education just now. That's what's interesting. It's almost like design and as a kind of way of doing things. But we also do some traditional stuff as well.
I fully agree. But to go back to those that wish to go into a career, those that wish to have a career in design, how do they go on about using the distance learning process into getting portfolios, into getting more advanced for formulation in their profession?
I'm not too sure. I think there's not that much difference from a traditional, you know, how does an architect, say, put what they learn in a college into practice? Mm-hmm. I think the big difference for me would have been, well, it would go back to, first of all, that normal population again. And also because our students come from that background, a lot of them tend to either be already working and studying part-time, or have maybe transitioned from one higher education experience to another, or maybe are looking for employment opportunities, or maybe are in completely different situations. So again, one of the most important aspects of our learning model is that students are necessarily bringing their context to the learning. So they're almost like bringing their own expertise in some ways to the learning. And we have a lot of students that will then, you know, go back into that context. So, for example, they could be, say, in an architectural practice, but they're working as an architectural technician or an engineering technician, and they're taking a design, you know, one of our modules to enhance that. And they'll maybe progress in their careers as a result of that, or they'll maybe use it as a way to transition from one employment to another. Mm. So it's almost kind of like intertwined in a way that we can't, it's almost the black box again, that we almost can't predict. We can support because we know what the aims are rather than the outcomes, if that makes sense. Mm-hmm. I would say it can vary quite considerably.
Brilliant. So if we could sort of do design education differently, if we could build it from scratch, or, you know, what would you keep, replace, remove, add? Would you change anything?
I have no idea how to answer that question, Lefteris, because it's just one of those horrible. If you weren't you and you didn't know what you already know,
design open university from scratch or any university.
Or the open university, right.
Or any university from scratch. Or if you could build the ideal university, what would you do differently?
Again, the from scratch thing, I do struggle with that a little bit, simply because I think we are all products of our own mistakes. Mm-hmm. We're all products of like the previous generation's mistakes. It's almost as if Lefteris, like I almost needed to rebel against even just me saying I was never taught how to design. You know, that's me almost being critical of my education, when in actual fact my education was actually exceptionally privileged. You know, the fact that I have turned out to be able to say that is you know, that's a credit to the educational system that I went through. So I think there is this kind of necessary thing, this necessary process almost of us using sort of past mistakes to create what the future is going to be. Mm-hmm. Now, one of the problems we have just now is that that works up to a point, but once you get to a certain population size, like 8 billion people on the size of this planet, and you have then suddenly a critical event, such as what's happening just now, mm-hmm. that kind of system is quite a long sort of process and system. So the one big thing that I would change to shortcut this, and actually I did a TED talk on this one recently, because fundamentally we are unsustainable as a species because of that. You know, our population is almost necessarily, well, it's not necessarily going to crash. It's going to crash because of the decisions we make. You know, we could theoretically support an 11 or 13 billion population on this planet quite easily. The numbers are there to be able to do it, but we choose not to. And we don't necessarily choose not to consciously. We choose for a load of bad reasons. And you can see that playing out in certain countries around the world. I won't name any countries whatsoever.
Absolutely, absolutely.
But you can see that where people are stopping forming their own ideas and opinions, or forming opinions in different ways. So the big change I would make, and this is one thing that we could do within a very short generational timescale, we could move design education from higher education right back into primary education. Mm. One, because it's already there, okay? Mm. We just don't express it. And this is the point that the summation, the culmination of a good higher education and design education is the recognition of what you do as being valuable. We don't. We do the opposite in primary schools and secondary schools. At some point in that process, we say, drawing with coloured pencils is wrong. Only drawing Absolutely. With blue ink or black Absolutely. Ink and writing on lined paper is Absolutely. Correct. Absolutely. And we apply these. We don't say that explicitly even. This is the worst bit. It's like in every little bit of body language. You can't respond to this question by using a picture. You've got to do it this way. Yes. It's almost implicit in everything. Now, if we stop doing that and we actually recognise the value of certain processes way back in primary school education, and that's supposed to be what's happening in some curriculum, such as Scotland, for example, the Curriculum for Excellence, one of the five pillars of that is supposed to be creativity. It'd be great to see that valued as equally to writing, reading, numeracy, all of those other things as well, because it is as valuable. And it's simply because it's ubiquitous. We automatically change our environment round about us all the time anyway. We automatically design day in, day out, but we don't necessarily develop the competencies to design well or to take it further, mm-hmm. to do better. And I think if we actually started developing that, you would automatically generate education or a cohort in an education system that were enabled as self-learners, as self-critiquers, as more critically enabled, shall we say, thinkers and learners further up the chain.
Absolutely. No, I've been saying it that the root of all the challenges we're facing with students in higher education is to be found in early years. Yep. That is for sure.
Precisely.
And that's purely for the fact that the world that education is preparing students for doesn't exist anymore.
No, that comes in many
levels, and it goes very, very deep.
Yeah.
And that's, it's like that. And you've been doing these wonderful open discussions on distance learning. I think you're having one this Friday.
We have, we'll go one tomorrow.
Could you tell us a bit more about that?
Absolutely. The one on Friday is going to be interesting. So on Friday, hopefully. Yep. So it's tomorrow at 3:30 UK BST. We can stick a link to the events.
Well, yes, please.
It'll be too late by the time this goes out.
We'll try and forward it a bit. Yeah.
But, okay. Cool. Yeah, no, that'd be good.
Tell us about how that began. Tell us about the beginning. The first, second, third episodes, and what we're going to see tomorrow.
Sure. So, again, one of the ways we tried to sort of support colleagues early on was to try to just have meetups just to discuss or just to find out what issues were. Again, it's the classic. We could sit and turn around and ask, what do we think it is that people are having problems with? Mm. But that's an old-fashioned way of designing. If you want to think of it that way, you're far better to just see what the problems are, mm-hmm. ask people what the problems are. And so many issues came out in that first discussion. It was more of an open discussion. So the second one, the follow-up one was on, I think it was on supporting students. I can't remember actually now. No, it was on assessment. And then the third one, I think that was on, I think that was hosted by, Leslie Ann hosted that one. I can't remember what the subject was. That's terrible. It's all blurring into one. But anyway, tomorrow's one is going to be interesting because we will be trying to look at what comes next. I think we need to transition from this mode of, we've tried to do things in an emergency and people have been coping really well. But I think people are starting to realise just how tiring it is to replicate proximate practice at a distance. So, for example, one of the things we would never do at the Open University is proximate practice. You know, we would never have constant one-to-one synchronous communication with students because it's exhausting for everybody. You have to stagger it. You have to stage it in particular ways. So I think we maybe have to come up with some kind of medium-term plan as a community. It would be lovely to do it as a community so that not everybody is having to reinvent the wheel every single time. You know, because if we are now isolated in certain ways as educators in a way that we have never been isolated before, we really need to come together as a larger community so that we get benefits of scale, benefits of using open educational resources. And then maybe we need to look a bit further into the future, maybe a bit longer term. And again, this is maybe where our expertise at designing curriculum, at planning, as you say, experiences, Left Terrace might come in. I mean, I would really love to, maybe in a few weeks' time, start maybe doing almost design workshops for curriculum. I think it'd be really nice to take, you know, a problem. This is the way that we design our curriculum is by designing it. You know, we take a design approach to it. It kind of comes very naturally to us as educators, design educators. So it'd be nice to try and play with that over the next. So that's what we're going to be talking about tomorrow. Got some interesting prompt stuff. We've also got actually some really nice prompt articles. There's five or six articles sort of discussing this. How do we move from responding in an emergency to responding a bit more strategically, planning stuff out by different design educators, sometimes distance educators. There's a nice one by Lorraine Marshallsey. She's got an article. I'm going to be putting a link up to that a bit later. Just reflecting on her pivot from proximate education, because a few colleagues have said just how much they miss the studio. They miss it emotionally, they miss it physically, they miss being with students, they miss drawing, they miss sketching. That's a thing, okay? That's a really important thing. We can't not acknowledge what we've lost. So it'd be good to actually reflect on what we've lost, maybe what we've gained, maybe what we could do more of. You know, the classic kind of reflection thing. So that's the plan for tomorrow. So please,
that sounds very exciting.
Everybody would be welcome.
Yes, yes, we will spread the word. It sounds very, very, very exciting. So tell us how our viewers and listeners can find more about you and your work.
So the blog just now is probably the best first place. I've only recently set it up as well, so I haven't even memorized the URL. So it's distancedesigneducation.com. If you have a look at that, that's more about the work, I suppose, than me, and I'm absolutely fine with that. I think it's the work that's the more important and the more interesting thing. And again, that's not my work, that's a collective. So please, anybody that wants to get involved, anybody that wants to contribute, you know, I think now more than ever, we need to be sharing as much as we possibly can.
Absolutely.
And please don't think you have to be an expert in this. You're an expert, as you said earlier, Left Terrace, you know, with respect to the client. You're an expert in what you experience. You're an expert in what you feel or are going through in this process. So, yeah, we need those voices and perspectives too.
Absolutely, absolutely. So any other comments or anything you'd like to leave us with, anything sort of to contribute?
That's a big one. No. Not too sure. I think, I suppose, it would be just to reinforce maybe some of the things I've already mentioned. I mean, particularly with what we're doing with this pivot, I know it's difficult to look at this as an opportunity. Again, I would maybe kind of flip it slightly. It's not that I'm trying to be optimistic about things or doing the kind of, and I don't like sometimes to see that in designers where you're almost aggressively optimistic to the point of ignoring, you know, sometimes what is a pretty pessimistic context that some people are in.
But you have to be optimistic to be a designer. You know, it's such a tough job that if you're not optimistic, then there's no way you can be one.
this is the thing. I mean, that, and again, to go back to that TED talk, one of the things that I would like to give to students in primary school would be a series of cognitive superpowers. And one of them I've called an optimism switch. You're absolutely right, Left Ellis. You have to be able to switch that on right there as soon as your client asks or a student asks. And you have to be able to say, how could the world be different? And there is no, you know, you can do that pessimistically too, but you have to be able to say, how might this be different? Because that's your job as a designer. I think the key comes in switching that superpower off and going back to being a pragmatist or a pessimist and saying, right, what needs to be done to make this work? Because it can't just be pure optimism, because otherwise you get these really crappy superficial designs, and I hate them. I'm seeing so many just now. just these really optimistic.
Not in that way.
No, not in that way. Overly optimistic. Unrealistic, let's say.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. So yeah. A few superpowers would be quite good just now.
Mm. What about the idea that current research tends to take into consideration only recent findings? Mm-hmm. And I understand that you and I are also inspired by other findings from the past by combining the best of all worlds.
Yep.
How could that help us today?
Totally. And thanks for the prompt on that one as well, Lev Terrace. Yeah, I think you're talking about some of the work that we talked about last time, which goes back to the 60s and 70s. Because there is nothing new to this. This is the weird thing. You know, with design thinking or design methods or design cognition, whatever you call it, you know, we are repeating the same things time and time and time again. Mm. And I think it would be good to recognize that a bit more, so that when we do come up with something new, we do recognize that we are actually building on some of this work. And I think that's starting to happen slowly, and particularly in design education in some circles just now. We are starting to refer more to previous work. And it means that we're referring to our own, if you like, work, and recognizing that we're actually starting to build it up as a body of knowledge. Mm. And it means that other colleagues, it's harder for them to dismiss us, because it's very easy sometimes to dismiss a lot of design education research, because sometimes it's not as critical as it could be, or sometimes, and I'm guilty of this too. Well, it's not guilty. It's simply a matter of our practice. Mm-hmm. You're sometimes a practitioner, you're a teacher, and then having to engage in scholarship as well. That is so difficult. That's three languages, okay? You've got your practitioner language, you have your teaching language, and then suddenly you've got to learn all these big words or different ways of doing things to put it into formal research. I'd love to help colleagues do that a bit better as well, because even just writing a good design case is hard. You know, look at Elizabeth Bowling's work on that. That's fantastic stuff, because it helps practitioners write a case. Just simply say, this is what I did, this is what I think you can learn from it. So it's been difficult for us as design educators and design researchers to do that. And it means that other education researchers, they have time to do some of these things. They maybe don't have that sort of spread. And it's been easy to dismiss design education as something that's the black box again that you can't describe. And I think what's exciting about more recent educational research, like the sticky curriculum stuff from Susan Orr, from others, from Lillian Marshallsey, and so on and so forth, these conceptual ideas of what design is, they are really helping to articulate the complexity and contradiction, if you like, in design education in a much more mature way. And they're using existing bodies of knowledge to do that. And that's really exciting. I think it's actually good time for design education in some ways. Well, it was until, you know, the proverbial hit the fan. But maybe that's a good thing too, because I'm seeing so many good reflective accounts of what's happening. This is making people stop and say, oh, shit, how do I actually do this? How am I going to teach at a distance? What happens if I am not there? And I think a lot of people are actually starting to come up with some really, really articulate and interesting reflective pieces to what is a really difficult thing to do. So, yeah, interesting times.
Well, that's fantastic. Thank you so much. We will be publishing this today so that it can go into the fourth episode of tomorrow's event. So we're looking forward to this.
That'll be a good timing then. So, yeah, we'll make sure it's cross-posted and we'll...
Thank you so much.
Yeah, no, thank you, Lefter. It's been great to chat. Yeah. Thank you. Okay.